Thank you, Dr. Heminger. Any final questions or board members before I ask for a roll call vote?
Yes, this is Dr. Brinkman. I do have a few things I do want to point out about the Caltrain board and the Caltrain staff and the SamTran staff, just to sort of help set the record straight. I spent almost 3 years on the Joint Powers Board, and I admit I did start with the idea that we in San Francisco were more empathetic and aware of equity and equality issues in transportation, that somehow we were more progressive in our policies. But what I saw and heard from my fellow board members showed me to be wrong about that. Doing a quick look back in my meeting notes, I found that we had a fair equity study brought to us in January 2018, possibly earlier, but that was the first time I found it in my notes. And I remember my colleagues from all three counties coming down solidly on the side of better fare policies for our lower income riders. Not once was there pushback on the idea that we had to make some fixes both in tandem with the MTC regional means-based fare program and on our own by making sure that those who could least afford the fares were indeed paying the least. And yes, we still have work that remains to be done, but no one was ignoring the issue of fare equity. Developable land is another good learning curve for me. The idea was, oh, Caltrain has all these parking lots, let's build money-making things on them. The board I served on agreed with staff that a comprehensive real estate survey needed to be done, and it was. That survey showed that we had two plots of land large enough and not needed for future operations to work on developing. Most of what Caltrain has is scrap land. It's too small to really do anything with until it's combined with nearby property or until the agency could possibly build over the electrified tracks. The housing policy passed by Caltrain Board in February 2020 requires that 30% of each transit-oriented housing development is offered to about below market rent. And again, all three counties came down solidly on that policy. I want to thank the board I served with, the current JPV board, and all the staff of Caltrain and SamTrans who overlap a lot. So many of them wear two hats. What I saw was a dedicated professionalism. What I saw was a concern for customers, a desire and a path to turn Caltrain into a system that by 2040 will handle the 40% increase of jobs and residents within 2 miles of each station. Last week, I was simply pushing for a clean measure to go before the voters. Then I said I'd support any measure that made its way to the ballot. But now I realize that was a bit naive. As I read more opinions, including that from the special counsel from SamTrans and those who crafted and voted for the state legislation which enabled this ballot measure, I feel I have to vote no. I worry that the current resolution is unwinnable and vulnerable. None of the board members I served with were against considering governance changes, but it was never clear to me what those changes should be. I would like to recommend to SF that in our quest for more input on governance and governance changes, that one area of focus would be the SF representatives to the Caltrain board. Make sure we have engaged board members like Director Heminger, Director Zamuda, Director Walton. Make sure they attend meetings and dial into briefings. Make sure they have the time to devote to this important job. When I served on the JPB, I found it a challenge to represent the SF opinion and interests when I couldn't always get clarity on what those interests and opinions were. I believe I'm doing the right thing. It certainly would be easier for me to hold my nose and vote yes, but on this, I simply cannot.